What that means.
No one knows what it means, but it's provocative.
No, it's not. It
gets the people going.
Well, Hector, here's the game plan. You're gonna bring us two absolute martinis. You know how I like them, straight up. And then precisely 7 1/2 minutes after that, you're gonna bring us two more. Then two more after that, every 5 minutes until one of us passes the fuck out.
You got a bad attitude, and you don't listen.
Oh, yes. There will be blood. It is not the violence that sets man apart. All right, it is the distance that he is prepared to go.
Ever notice how you come across somebody once in a while that you shouldn't have fucked with? That's me.
Cocaine and hookers, my friend.
Welcome to the Max Ordinate Podcast.
What's up, Max Ordinate Nation? Jeff, we got special guests today. We got Chris from Veil Solutions with us.
What's going on?
How's it going?
We'll save this for the end of the episode. I sent you the show notes, did I not, Jeff?
Yes, you did.
And
I'm looking at them now, or I was till I accidentally shut them down. There we go.
You know, so before we get into the Veil Solutions and Chris and what led us here is, you weren't here last week. Where the fuck were you?
I was here last week. I was here till Tuesday. Somebody didn't send me a link. So, as you know, like I got an office up in NorCal and we moved offices from our own nice little office, but we moved to basically like a big shopping center. And now what's cool about this is it's a storefront shopping center, but we share it. We're giving the local PD part of our office for a storefront. Now, they have DOJ rules, so they have to kind of have their own entrance and exit. But I kind of just went up there to lay it out, sort of how we wanted it decorated, how it needed to look logistically, because it'll be our main NorCal office where we got to shuffle 80 guys through. So it's pretty exciting to have like a big like storefront. We share, you know, it's a Target / Dollar Tree shopping center. So
I saw that one office. I instantly saw where the putting green and you know, the video screen would go for you to hit long drives and, you know, with all your hard work.
I got that here. I got that here at the house. Those guys get no fun stuff.
So last week, I did not release it to any of the public outlets, no YouTube, no nothing, strictly just Patreon. I'll have to send it to you. And it kind of ties into what we're talking with Chris about today is, you know, I got Nick, team shooter Nick asking me about a training program because they're getting back into precision gas gun shooting for some of the matches that are coming up and they're rusty. Things aren't clicking. Things, they're just, you know, he's not happy with where they're at. Russ is, you know, same thing, just feeling rusty. So I put together this training plan that can be done in the garage, can be dry fire, you could go to the range, you can execute it, right? But you could do the entire thing every day, which I'm estimating it would take somewhere around an hour to an hour and a half. If you're going to dedicate that kind of practice, then, you know, good on him. Or if you do it once a week, right, you could break it up into segments. But it all started with basic shit. And when I'm talking about this training program on the episode, it was breaking down not just the drill, but and Chris, you could probably appreciate this, but what is the purpose or the intent behind each drill, right? Like we have, you know, every different drill that you could think of. You look at our website, we've got downloadable targets, right? But everything's got to have an intent and purpose behind it. And it might not capture everything when we think about what goes into taking a perfect shot, right? But training certain areas. So I broke down this training plan, and, you know, a lot of it come down to, for precision gasser, not just the fundamentals, but natural point of aim and being able to get on target quickly. So just quickly, just real fast, what's your suggestion, Chris, for how would you train somebody to be able to get on target quickly, right? Because if you think about a competitive style arena, you get up there and the gas gun matches are all time-based, right? They're unlike bolt gun matches where it's like you got to hit to get points. Gas gun is more almost unlimited ammo, and it's how fast can you get through the course of fire. So if I make it through in 35 seconds and Jeff makes it through in 37 and you're right there at 37, you guys would get a percentage of my 100 points for that stage. So a lot of it's being efficient, being able to get on target, and then executing the target with, you know, precision, hopefully first round impact, right? But you want to save time in every area that you can. So for me, what I did was all of these drills that they're going to practice, whether it's live fire or dry fire, it's getting into position and having that natural point of aim within 4 mils. So once they're up on the rifle and they look through their scope, if that target's not within 4 mils, that's a fail and they got to reset. And they're looking, how can they improve how they get into position so that they fall within 4 mils once they're on target? You know, whether it's looking over the scope, looking down the side of the rifle, whatever you have to do. And then the other thing is putting them on maximum power. Even if they don't shoot on maximum power, but if they got a 35 power scope, I want them on 35 power so that it forces them to fine tune the details of how they're getting on target downrange faster. What would you throw in there?
Man, I'm writing notes now too. You know, and it's like, you know, some of those things you said are, you know, things that I haven't thought of in a lot of ways. And, you know, to be upfront about everything, man, is like, I'm not a notoriously awesome, you know, long range gas gun guy. I'm not a, you know, crazy good bulk, like I don't shoot PRS a ton or anything. Like, you know, I got into the quantified performance matches, you know, 5 or 6 years ago, whenever they started. I've been shooting them since the beginning. And in the last year, I don't even think I've made one, honestly, but they're great matches. And I fell in love with, you know, a lot of the precision rifle stuff. I think, you know, I love carbine shooting, one of my main classes is like a kind of a carbine class that has all these things in, you know, taken into account. And, you know, you kind of hinted at it, you know, the efficiency of things, that's something that I'm always kind of, I'm looking towards. And it, you know, it's easy to say that, but it's really kind of when you break it all down, you know, 'cause there's pieces to all these puzzles or pieces of these drills, and it's you know, people either they rush into drills and they rush into position to try to get in there, and then, you know, they get there fast, but then, you know, they end up crashing into position, and they have to, the natural point of aim piece is almost all kind of messed up because of, you know, how poorly they landed, right? Or the other side of the house is there's just like there's no efficiency. They're doing everything they possibly can, you know, how they hold the rifle or how they you know, have their feet planted and everything. It's like there's so much inefficiency, you know, just kind of how they start the process to begin with, right? And you know, some of that goes back to like on the gamer side of the house. You know, I come from a three gun kind of competition background and stuff, more so than probably anything. And it's like I always say, play the game for what it's worth, right? So like if I'm playing, you know, doing a competition or shooting a match or shooting a drill, it's like, yeah, I want to try to gain that drill or that match to give myself the best advantage that I possibly can to win. But you know, like you said earlier too, is you know, purpose and intent. Well, you know, are we talking about gaming, or are we talking about you know, practical application of things in the real world or whatever you want to call it, right? So it's I believe both sides of the house. It's like, all right, if we're gaming, all right, let me find, you know, I'll start with my feet a certain way, or I'll start with my grip on the rifle already set up to, you know, to work the barricade or whatever it is, right? Because it's the gamer side. But then I also think making things more difficult more often is actually a big piece of the puzzle as well. I'm notorious for saying far too many people win far too often, and I think that they're good at that, you know, they go shoot a bill drill with their pistol and they check the box and they pat themselves on the back, and I, you know, it's like, all right, well, back up or reduce the time or make the target smaller or all the above. And I think those are things that kind of go into it. But what you, I think if we train, you know, the old cliche, I think if we train to make things harder, you know, you saying you actually have guys over glass on purpose, that's actually really super interesting to me. That's something I hadn't thought of, because normally we see people over glass unnecessarily, you know, for a lot of stuff, especially kind of in the low power world. And it's, you know, I almost always have guys back it down because they don't need that much magnification. Things look, they're moving faster. It starts playing mind tricks with them and stuff. But you saying over glassing on purpose, you know, within 4 mils to kind of get that rep during, you know, is like, man, that's something I'm really going to play with moving forward next time I go to the range. But one thing specifically to kind of answer your natural point aim question and stuff is I always try to have guys like see what the end state looks like. Right. So like, hey, what does perfect look like on, you know, what's the end goal? Right. And then I have guys try to like reverse engineer it. So like in one of my carbine classes, we do a bunch of positional work, and I give guys a chance to go through it all. And, you know, try and learn something from their own experiences, you know, heuristics or inductive style training. They get a chance to experience it and kind of see like, hey, maybe they can pick up something on their own that I don't have to sit there and teach them. And then we'll go and we'll talk about it. But the thing is like, hey guys, like you have to hit this 4-inch plate at 100 yards or this 6-inch plate at 200 yards or whatever, like figure out how you have to get in that position to be as stable as possible to make that hit. And then reverse engineer backwards from that, right? So like see how your feet are set up, see all this stuff. So like when you're 5 yards out from getting in this position, you already know what the end state looks like. You know, and again, it's like, hey, I know my natural point of aim in this position is suboptimal. I'm giving up a little bit of stability or something to, you know, for a little bit of durability or whatever, but it's like you have the chance to kind of see what perfect looks like and then work back from there. So having guys do that, that seems to be a big light bulb moment for guys when like, hey, I know I have to have this knee down and I know I have to get, you know, points of contact with the rail, you know, in a corner or whatever it is. Like they know what that looks like on the back end, so they can start reverse engineering. So by the time they get there and get in position, you know, hopefully they're within that 4 mil window that you said. So without, you know, having to make all those corrections, if that makes sense.
That's a good way of thinking about it, man. I didn't, you know, I like the reverse engineering, you know, almost like, and when I'm talking about these drills, I'm talking about like guys who have been to, you know, they're at least at an intermediate level and they can somewhat process and maybe break down some of their own issues, you know, but taking an individual and putting him in the position and saying, this is where you're supposed to be. Now, how do we get there? Like, you know, and we talk about that a lot because you know, as well as me and Jeff, is a lot of the times with, you know, whether if it's law enforcement, cool, we get like 5 days with these guys. If it's civilian guys, it's, you know, Friday through or Saturday through Monday, you know, 3 days. But then after those 3 days, how prepared are they to go and start training on their own without fucking it up, you know? And, you know, having that tool of, hey, when you're confused or when you're trying to figure something out, why don't you try reverse engineering? I like that. That's cool.
Yeah, I dig that. It's almost like having your notes to take home. And when you're struggling with something, just look at your notes real quick and work backwards. So that's a pretty good way to look at it. You know, Tyler's notorious for making things extraordinarily difficult on us for a purpose, but we talk about it all the time that, you know, you got to be comfortable failing and looking like an idiot on the range if you want to succeed. Right. So, part of every drill I've seen and every drill that we have is always for a purpose, but, sometimes they're more difficult than the average person would want them, but, it's for a reason. And I think what I'm saying is the practicality of having it that difficult is part of the purpose of the drill, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
I mean, I, you know, I'm, you guys do like MMA or jiu-jitsu or striking or anything. You guys ever done any of that? I'm sure to some degree. I'm a very terrible blue belt in jiu-jitsu right now. So, you know, I go in there and I get beat up every single day. And it's like, people don't understand, you know, when it comes to shooting, like I mentioned earlier, is they go to the range and they win all the time, right? They just pat themselves on the back and they move on. And it's not apples to apples, right? It doesn't translate perfectly because it's you against yourself. But like, you know, you get good at jiu-jitsu by going four times a week, right? You get good at shooting by going four times a week. You know, you make things harder because you need that resistance in your training to make progress, right? Like you don't grow muscle by going to the gym and lifting, you know, a 10 pound weight, you know, just a couple of times or whatever. Like you have to have that resistance and that pushback. So, you know, people, I think, ignore the fact that they need to go lose and, you know, don't lose so much that it defeats you as a person, right? And like, you know, it crushes your soul, but, you know, going to have that resistance and stuff is necessary to progress, I believe. So I think it's awesome.
The jiu-jitsu comparison is interesting because I think my first exposure to, I was a wrestler. So like my entire existence as a child was dedicated to wrestling. And then getting into the Marine Corps, like when I first joined the Marine Corps, like there was some martial arts program, but nobody really took it seriously until I was older, probably in the Marines 5 or 6 years. And then we actually started going and like beating each other's ass on the mats. And some guys took it far beyond what the Marine Corps had pushed to you. So like, I remember Luke was just this baller, right? And he fights professionally even today. And we'd be rolling around and, you know, dude, put me in some fucking position or lock me up in some way. I'm like, how the fuck did you get that? Like, you know, and when you look at it in that reverse method that you're talking about, the jiu-jitsu part is you can learn the move, right? And that's all fine and dandy, but you don't truly understand that technique or you know, that arm bar or whatever it is that you're trying to do until you can hit it from any fucking position, right? And you've seen it like in the pros on UFC. Like I remember seeing a video of Ronda Rousey hitting a fucking arm bar from like upside down standing position, and you can't do that if you don't understand the entirety of it, right? And it's kind of the same thing with shooting. If you were to apply that level of thinking, like if you can understand all of these foundational principles that go into shooting, right, then you're able to start to adapt outside of a square bay. Like, how do I apply this to every situation, right? And it just comes down to understanding, and I think experience has a lot to do with it, you know. And you know, some of the experience you can gain from training. And then the other part is adding the stress to it, whether it's a competitive environment or, you know, it could be force on force, you know, like see a lot of these combative training courses all throughout social media where, you know, dudes are shooting around a car, shooting, you know, they're going through a house or a simulated, you know, plywood house and whatever. And everything looks great right up until you give the force on force people simunitions, and then the game changes, right?
It does.
Fast. The amount that you stick your head out around that fucking corner gets a lot smaller, right? And so that's something that we've done here at the Urban Sniper course is we have an entire week dedicated to urban hides and urban movement. And now we've implemented UTMs and SESMs into this training for a couple days. Particularly their breakout drills, right? So they'll be in their hide site, they'll take their shot, they'll be live role players all around the city. They'll take their shot and now they're compromised. Now we're not going to tell the role players where these dudes are, but the shot should pretty much give a general area of, I think they're over in this way, right? So now the sniper team has got to break down and get out of that building, and they might potentially have to fight their way out with these paintball rounds, right? And it's going to change the game versus these guys just, you know, breaking all their shit down, shoving their shit in the pack. Hey, you ready? And they go to the rooftop, they rappel down the rope and like, hey, we made it out. Like, it's not going to be that easy this time, you know, like it's time to get a sense of realism. So, you know, some of that stuff, you just, you got to find, you got to get creative in how you train, you know? So,
it's funny. Anybody who's listened to this podcast for longer than 3.5 minutes knows I compare everything to golf, and Tyler compares everything to climbing. Right. And now we've just lumped in, Brazilian jiu-jitsu into the mix. Right. So I think the big picture is, if you look at it, it really shows that shooting sports, whether it's carbine work, whether it's long range stuff, I mean, whether it's pistol, it's still a sport that has a basic set of human rules, right? How we learn, how we think, how we produce an end product based on what information we're given. So I think if we do what we've done before, which we look at the training as a whole as sort of this human element of what are other sports doing? What are other disciplines doing, and working that into, you know, how we train. It's funny that every, you can look at almost any sport, anybody else's hobby that they bring into this sport, and there's comparisons in how they train doing that versus how they train doing this. And when you get to the higher level, they all start to get really close together.
That, and
so
go ahead.
I was gonna say, I forgot that you were a climber. I bouldered for many years as well, right when I got out of college. But you know, the fact that Jeff mentioned the the sport thing in general is like,
I have one of these. I don't know what to do with it.
But I played college football as well, so I played football my whole life growing up and everything. And it's like I think a lot of the reasons I've been sort of successful at shooting, I guess, is because a lot of the athleticism from football. And it's like, hey, I didn't have to be athletic. That box was already checked, so I could, you know, put everything into shooting and stuff like that. So I think there's definitely a lot of good carryover and caveats. And like Jeff said too, is like everything starts to look the same in so many ways, even though the disciplines are all different. Like the path to the top is, you know, kind of like a pyramid, I guess you'd say, but it's super interesting.
Every sport, every competitive event, like you look at anything out there, right? It doesn't matter what it is. Everything has foundational basics, right? And every sport that has elite athletes talks about being brilliant in those basics. I mean, that fact doesn't change. So,
yeah, excellence at the fundamentals, for sure. Yeah.
So, moving on. What is Veil Solutions? I looked at the website. Honestly, I think at one point I either came across your page or you followed me and then I followed you. And I mean, looking at your page, there's pistol, carbine, and it looks like you guys also do a lot of kydex.
The kydex thing is kind of, it's not the biggest thing right now. Like originally that was kind of the starting point. When I got into this, probably 12 years ago or something, that's kind of the thing that jumped everything off, and that's paid the bills, probably for the last 8 or 9 years, majorly. But, that whole time I was doing that is I was shooting competition. I was shooting IDPA, USPSA, three gun and all that stuff. So there was always kind of a carryover, so all the money I was making for making holsters went directly into me wasting a bunch of money shooting matches and, trying to chase excellence when it came to shooting. But, you know, during that time as well, like I, was working some low-level security stuff in Atlanta, nothing cool, doing some other stuff. It's kind of when I started rolling jiu-jitsu and training. So that kind of carried over to the security, side of the house too. And, I've had a chance to do some cool stuff in certain places, different places. And in the last probably 6 years, it's probably taken a turn from the competitive side of the house to more in the kydex side, to more instruction and, practical use of tools and stuff like that. I've carried a gun every day since I was 21. I have no intentions of not, doing that anytime. So, it's like, I found an appreciation for, the competitive side of the house, chasing something, to excellence or as close to it as I could manage. And then it's like, hey, day to day, this is super important to me. I carry a gun every day, this is at a foundational level. It's what I believe in. you know, of self-preservation and protection and all that, you know, the man stuff. You know, I think there's a lot of good in that, you know, being the protector without, you know, all the cliches and stuff, but, that's kind of where it's been. I taught, I don't know how many classes, nothing super crazy, maybe 20 or so a couple years ago. You know, I probably taught 10 or more, 15 last year, you know, open enrollment and some private stuff too. And then this year is going to be a slow year for me, but that's all by design. So kind of the cool thing about Vail is I can kind of shift and pivot in a lot of ways. People are like, why don't you release your 2024 calendar? And I was like, man, I don't know what I'm going to be doing next year. You know, I might be teaching a bunch. This year has been super like product heavy, doing some other stuff. Like I helped Rich at Darcy developed an explosive breaching system, right? So like I got to 3D design and CAD and go through that whole process of, you know, designing this initiation system for explosive breaching. So it's like, I don't know where I'm going to be or what I'm going to be doing, but it's going to revolve around, you know, this kind of lifestyle, whatever you want to call it, you know, belief system or whatever. So, I love chasing something to the absolute end. You know, I believe in like isolation of training, but I also don't want to be so good at one thing that I neglect everything else. If that makes sense. So a couple years ago it was jiu-jitsu, you know, I was rolling 3 or 4 times a week, 5 times a week. And now it's just like, I just do it just to keep up with stuff. Same thing with pistol training or rifle training. A couple years ago it was precision gas guns. But it's just kind of, I enjoy so much. I don't want to pigeonhole myself into one thing. You know, you might call it jack of all trades, master of none, but, it's just, I really enjoy all this and I really enjoy, you know, the different individual pieces of it all. So, and kind of going back to what we were saying earlier is like, man, I can, by me shooting, like I rewrote my whole carbine curriculum training, whatever, because of the time I spent shooting, like, you know, long range gas guns. I was like, oh my God, this positional stuff is way more important than I thought it was. Yeah. Like I need to pay homage to this in class, you know? So, it's kind of cool, you know, the things I learned from other avenues come back and, you know, like the sports comments earlier, it's like, it all kind of comes back. So, I don't know, just kind of a weird, enigma of things, if you will. But it's, like I said, it's kind of cool because I can pivot, and if I got to turn it all back on and make kydex, you know, until I cry, I can do that tomorrow if I have to, you know? So.
Nice. When I was on your website, there was one thing. Like I'm reading through different stuff and I'm kind of like digging into the website and I get to a certain part where you're talking about like lead times and like, you know, basically it's like a note of like, have fucking patience. Okay. We'll fucking finish your shit. But then there's another one. There's like a disclaimer and it's like, we'll make Ghost for every platform that it's safe. And I was like, ooh, it's something dangerous. What is a ghost? And so I had to keep digging. And what is this ghost holster? I mean, is it basically a method of concealed carry that is minimal and just covers the trigger and safety measures?
Yeah, and it's probably been our best selling holster for the last, I don't know, 8 or 9 years since I made that. And you know, I made that holster because I had a Raven Vanguard back in the day and stuff like that. I just had issues and concerns with it personally. So I did what I thought I could do to improve that idea. And it's, you know, the internet can ruin anything. And I've had more issues with that. I've had companies steal the design. I'm not saying I came up with the idea or the concept or whatever, but how that holster is actually physically made, I've had more than a few companies rip that off almost exactly or exactly. And the concern of the issue is like, man, I carry a gun every day and I shoot a lot. I understand some of the concerns on the combative side of the house. I understand the concerns like, hey, this gun, you can't have this gun fall out. Right. So I think a lot of people got into kydex for the wrong reasons, to do something to make a bunch of money because they saw the opportunity to do it at a certain time. One thing I hope to always try to do is make a product that I believe in and would use. And money has never been the end state for me. If that was the goal for me, I'd be doing something different. But the goal is always to help people and to do the right thing. And you know, that holster, I think, has been an awesome thing for a lot of people. And obviously, like anything, you give up something to gain something, right? It's not a full shielded holster, but it has made people more likely or more able to carry in some ways, because they don't want to put this big old clunky thing on some ways, and they don't want to do this stuff. So it's, you know, and this isn't a sales pitch, but a lot of times I'm like, hey guys, it's, the holster is very inexpensive. It, you know, if you're a Glock guy like me or whoever else, like, it doesn't cost anything to leave one of those in your truck to make sure you always have, you know, second option if something happens or whatever, right? Or, you know, like the Hill People Gear kit bag, it's perfect, you know, to have a little tied off ghost in there to kind of do that. If you know, you're carrying a ruck or a pack and stuff, like when I go camping and hiking and stuff, I always have mine, you know, tucked up in there, because I'd rather always have that extra layer of protection if it doesn't cost me anything, so to speak, right? But that's, you know, like I said, probably one of the most popular designs. And you know, we've grappled with them, we've rolled with them, we've done combatives with them with sim guns and all that stuff. And we haven't found them to be as unsafe in so many ways as a lot of the other options out there. And that's always a point of contention with me, because MMP shields, well, can you make one for the shields? I was like, well, I'm sure you can, and I'm sure there's a way, but the process we do, it's very unsafe because the trigger guard's around it, so the gun rocks in the trigger guard because there's nothing kind of keeping it there, if that makes sense. So same thing with the P365s and all this other stuff guys are asking, and I was like, I refuse to make a product and put my name on something that I think is unsafe or detrimental to somebody's health or well-being. So it's just kind of one of those things. So those have been some of the most asked questions we've ever received, you know, on the product side of the house. But we still make them basically every day or every other day or whatever. So we still ship them, you know, weekly. And it's been a great option, I think, for a lot of people. I get photos all the time of people running a holster that's 8 years old. And I'm like, please throw that thing away. You know, it looks hideous. But I guess it's still working out for them.
So you're a Glock guy.
I appreciate everything. And the other side of the house on the manufacturing side is I refuse to ship a product or a holster without it being tested with a real gun. So, you know, doing blue guns or whatever, like, isn't an option for me. So I've had the pleasure of owning probably far too many pistols, probably seven, which I never would intend to own. But I keep coming back to Glocks. I shot 2011 super heavy, in competition and three gun for, you know, 5 or 6 years. And then, you know, I shot Glocks, P320s are, you know, they're one of the only other main guns I shoot because of, you know, the service side of the house. It's one of the, you know, the big service pistols. But you know, CZs, 1911s, M&Ps, all that, you know, I have them all. I keep coming back to the Glock for some reason. And I think the reliability has a lot, not that we're going to find any of those other pistols being unreliable, especially now, but, it's just my issue with like the 2011s. Everybody's on the 2011 bandwagon now. It's like, I don't want to conceal carry a pistol with a beaver tail digging me all day. I don't want to be uncomfortable. They're heavy as shit. And that stuff starts wearing on you, but also like the most important round is the first round. And I think getting a Glock out of the holster more consistently and efficiently makes more sense for a, you know, a civilian or somebody on the actual defensive side of the house. You know, because I've been in way more fights than I have gunfights, which is, you know, zero-ish. But it's like I've fought a lot with a lot of people doing, you know, security stuff and whatever. And it's like, I think getting that pistol out in that first round, within arm's reach or close to it is way more important than, cause once the 2011 is out, I'll give it to you. That thing, once it's out and running, it is the best option at that point. But I think, just some of the stuff on the Glock, I think makes more sense, day to day, day in and day out. So
what are you, Jeff? I don't even know what you are. You look to me like a Colt.
He's a sick guy.
I feel like he's a Colt six shooter fucking Jesse James type so man.
In my truck is my staccato.
Okay. Oh,
of course. But of course. I should have known that one.
My I've been shooting since 2011. I've been shooting an M&P 9, a 9C, and I've had every iteration since, and that's my EDC is my my 2.0 9C or my just 2.09 in whatever their agency build is.
Okay. But
that's just, you know, the grip angle for me. When I can shoot a Glock all day, I have one in my pack. I can't put a red dot on. It just doesn't work for me, but everything else I have has a dot on it, but my M&P is my go-to.
So Chris, you're talking about like jack of all, master of none. And we're like opposites, because I'm like jack of some, but master of one.
But again, I gotta tell you, hold on. I gotta tell you, anytime someone brings that up, you have to finish the quote, which is jack of all trade, master of none, but still better than a master of one, because we are all people that get really good at a lot of shit, but it's a whole lot better than being good at only one fucking thing.
You know, I'm like,
that's a good point.
I'm better than average on your pistol, you know, and then your carbine, I'm pretty good. But I mean, it doesn't compare to my precision game skills, you know.
For sure.
I'm just fucked. I'll just support you guys from over there. So I shoot a Glock, and I've never had really any interest in giving a fuck. I just want it to do what it's supposed to do. The grip angle did mess with me a little bit in the beginning, but you get used to it when you dry fire and you roll around with it. And you know, you say, in terms of reliability, what I've noticed is that, you know, since being here and taking on this contract, like now I have a SIG M18, and you know, it's a 320, but it's got a safety on it, and that's fine. But will it shoot? Yeah, it'll shoot. Have I ever had it stop or fuck up? Nope. That thing runs perfect, except for I've seen the rear sights come off. I've seen the front sight get lost. I've seen pieces of this pistol not survive training sessions, whereas I've never had that issue with my Glock. So, I mean, in terms of reliability, yeah, I think they'll all shoot, but I think some of them have some different areas that need special attention. You know, like if I were going to buy a M18 or a 320 out in the real world, I'd probably take the sights off and maybe red Loctite them, so I'm preventing a future problem that I've noticed happens on the firing line, right? So little stuff like that. So you were founded in 2014?
No. I think Vail is...
I was just looking at your website. Your website at the bottom says copyright 2014. So I was like, is that the year?
It is, I think, officially on paper. I think it is 2012, February 2012, or it might be 2013. I can't remember, but we've had the name Bale since, I think, 2011. So that name has existed since then. Just on paper and documentation and stuff. I think it's been since 2012 or 2013. It's older. I know for a fact it's older than 10 or 11 years old. From, you know, the old Facebook memories reminds me, because I can't keep up with anything. But it's basically when I got out of college, I was working another job too. Was working the security stuff and whatever. But I was making holsters and gear that whole time, the company actually started existing shortly thereafter that. So sometimes around 2012 or February 2012 or 2013. You probably know this, but.
Have you always had that logo? This will play into the end of the conversation.
I think that logo that is still on Instagram is still the original logo from whatever year that was. So I think that is still, I don't know if I've ever altered my profile picture on Instagram or anything.
So you're gonna appreciate this at the end of the show. We're gonna talk about your logo, but it appears that you are the OG, the OG. But we'll get into it. So what led me to all of this was I saw a video, right? And I think I commented on the video. I was asking some questions about a drill that you were running, and you told me it was a buddy of yours, Bruiser Industries, I believe.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, Joe.
And I don't know him. I don't think I know him. I've trained a lot of the LAPD D team guys, but I know John, and I know John works with Bruiser sometimes, but I don't think I know him directly. But anyway, I'm going to show this video. Let me see if I can pull it up here. This is where our technical skills kind of diminish, is showing you videos.
No, right, share screen works great. It's just whether or not it actually plays.
It's going to play. It's going to fucking play.
I mean, is it?
I don't know. We're going to try. Here we go. Can you see that video?
We got it.
All right, let's see if it plays. Here we go. So it's your typical ladder drill. You're firing two shots from the bottom, and then every level up, you got a transition, two shots, all the way. You're going all the way to the top, right?
Just the four positions. And it's Joe's ladder drill, and it's like word for word or whatever on his website. It says the bottom position is supposed to be seated. But I asked him a little bit for clarification because I knew I've run it both ways, and I think both multiple videos are up there. But I figured out I can basically shoot a lot faster from a double knee than I can shooting or a seated. Sorry. Yeah, there's just a lot going on with this drill in some ways. And I'm actually playing both sides of the drill, kind of back and forth between complete reliability of passing it and absolute chaos speed. Because I think both of them are very important skill sets. And somebody online basically said, hey, I think this drill can be shot in under 45 seconds in all hits. So that's kind of what I'm trying to prove in some ways, even though that drill was technically not a pass. So I technically failed that drill.
So what's the target? You said the target was an index card?
Yeah, it's, I guess, a 3x5 note card is what it is. And, you know, man, I'm all about chasing excellence and shooting sub-minute groups over and over and stuff like that. And like, hey, how well can I do this under stress as well? So, you know, I'll do that as well, depending on, you know, what day it is or what I'm working on. But also, like, I'm working the raw spitacity of, you know, that drill right now, working the movement piece, right? So it's, I think a lot of people are losing a ton of time. Shooting isn't the problem. If you ask me to hit that note card 14 times or whatever, like I could do that, right? But I think a lot of people lose the getting into position with a sense of urgency. You know, if I get in a position faster, I can get stable faster. You know, I can spend a little bit more time on making sure I get my hits if I kind of do these things. So in that specific instance of that video, my main focus there was basically the positional aspect of that drill. The good thing is that's something a lot of people can dry fire. So, you know, I didn't have to shoot that, but it's just one of those things I'm kind of working on. So,
yeah. So when I saw the drill, that was my main question, was what are you using it for? Like with every drill that we talked about in the beginning, there's intent, purpose, end state. And, you know, so it sounds like you're attempting sub 45 seconds with a pass. If there's four levels, two shots each, that's what, 16 shots?
Should be four, eight, 10, 12, four. It's 14. So, you don't shoot the top position.
Okay. So, correct. 14 shots, what constitutes a pass?
All rounds on the note card.
Okay. So, it's got to be 100% rounds on target.
Yeah. And he has a, like a 400 yard version of that drill as well, like on maybe a 10 inch piece of steel, I think it is, or something. But it's, or two MOA or whatever. I can't remember exactly what he says. And he also has a Vulcan version of that too, where it's just a single round, on a smaller target. Right. So, and again, I wholeheartedly agree with you with the purpose and the intent of it. So like, for me, it's always a back and forth. Like, I always encourage people when they're trying to do a drill. One thing I say is like, hey, is this even possible? Like, are you even capable of shooting this drill and passing in the first place? Right. Like, no time limit or anything. Can you even accomplish this? Like, okay, you can do that. Then we'll put a timer on it. Then it's how consistently can you do that under that time? Right. So it's like, for me, I know I can basically pass that drill 9 out of 10 times with under the time standard. Right. So like, I know I can do it under a minute, all hits, at least with that rifle and good ammo. I know I can do that consistently. So it's like, okay, now how fast can I do it? Try to make the wheels fall off. And then it's like, okay, how fast can I consistently do, you know, the drill? So hey, can I pass under 50 seconds or 55 seconds or whatever? So it's the pun here, but it's always about a ladder. Like I achieve something or whatever. So I add something else to it, like I mentioned earlier. So it's always kind of a balance between those things. And again, I chase the importance of precision, like hyper precision shooting and stuff, as possible. Like that's something I'll work on. But also for me, it's like the practicality of it for me is if I can hit a no card at speed quickly, more times than not, I'm not going to throw a blanket and say it's good enough all the time, because I think good enough is a cancerous word or phrase. But it's I think if I can hit a no card at speed at 100 yards, I think that's a pretty good aim point for most anything that I think you need to do, either in the gamer world or the practical world in so many ways. So, yeah.
So with that, to me, the details matter. How is the card oriented downrange? Is it, because it's 3x5, so it's a rectangle. Is it horizontal or is it vertical? Because each one of those gives you a benefit in a different direction.
Yeah. And I think on the paper, and I should look this up. I have a computer in front of me, but I think it says it needs to be vertical. But okay. I can't remember for sure. I absolutely agree. The details matter and stuff. And it's like, you know, if I was to game it one way or another, I would know what I could give up in certain aspects to get away with, you know, whatever that note card offers, or a position offers or whatever it is. So I don't discredit any of that. And it's funny. I think on that run in that video, I think I missed 2 rounds just off the note card on the right, like just almost touching it. And then I think 1 low, and I got a photo of it somewhere, but it's like, you know, in the grand scheme of things, like I think even in the video, you can hear me call one of my shots specifically and be like, oh, I fucked that one up. You know, and even called kind of where it is, which is, I think, you know, extremely important. Yeah. But
I'm just looking at the drill and, you know, trying to pull the details out of it and kind of looking at how, like, would this be a suitable drill to have, you know, like our team? We have a shooting team. We all travel together and compete. And, you know, now that precision gas gun things are picking back up, you know, Nick does a lot of the quantitative performance stuff. I know they canceled the Vegas match, but I mean, those are fun stuff, fun matches. But a lot of your ability to climb the leaderboard happens with stuff that's going on in this drill, right? Your speed, being able to keep rounds on target, your follow-up shots, you know. So for me, when I watch the drill and then after hearing you tell me what details are going into it, now I'm starting to look at like, okay, could we have the team do this? Could we film them? And then could we go back and look at, okay, the first thing we're going to discuss is how could you be more efficient? Like, look at your footwork here. You took 2 extra steps and you didn't need that, right? We could have done straight to this. Or you grabbed your rifle with your left hand, you moved to the next ladder rung, and then you had to reposition your body in your right-handed shooter. Like, you just fucked yourself. Your whole movement is now not efficient, right? So I would look at movement first, and then I would start looking at how is their positioning? Kind of talking about that natural point of aim and just being able to get on target, right? As soon as you're in that kneeling position, are you on it, right? Because typically what tends to happen, just from watching students and watching my own guys compete, and even knowing myself, right? I could get into a position if it's not fundamentally sound, right? And it's not always going to be. Sometimes you're not going to get that bone support that you need. So you're going to have some vertical wobble, or your natural point of aim isn't exactly right. How many people will take the time to fix that? And how many will try to just take the shot, right? Especially on a 3x5 card at 100 yards, you're looking at it, you're like, it's so big, I'm fucking hit this, right? And then it's a miss and you're like, fuck, right? So perfecting each position, right? And just knowing how your body, right? And I feel like there are certain cues that you can program yourself to have. So if I get onto that third rung of the ladder, as soon as I shoulder the rifle, I'm looking over the scope, I know that the target needs to be here in relation to what my naked eye sees. And then once I'm in the scope, I know that I'm on target and I have this general natural point of aim. And then I think the final part would, you know, I don't know if you preach this in any of your carbine stuff. It's kind of more of a precision rifle deal. But I know all of the disciplines, pistol, carbine, rifle, we all talk about recoil management. And that's a big one for me, is as I have students learning, I talk about having a 1 mil bubble, right? I want you to be able to shoot, and then the rifle should settle back down within 1 mil of where you aimed, right? That would be the good fucking recoil management. And it all comes down to like buttstock placement and body alignment. And, you know, if your body alignment's off, what are you doing with your non-firing hand to control the recoil? So I start looking at that area, right? Because I feel like if you can manage recoil to the point where you take a shot and the reticle's right back on your card, then you're already ready to take the next shot, right? So just some things that I would look at. But I'm not knocking the drill. I was interested in what it was. Mm-hmm. And then at the same time, wanted to put it out there, because if people see the drill, what I don't like is that your random Joes will go out and execute a drill not understanding everything that we just talked about. Like, oh, I'm going to do this drill that I saw Chris do, and I'm going to do it as fast as I can, right? But he has no idea that you've already run this drill 3 or 4 times a little slower, trying to get better at your position. You've done it in 60 seconds, and now you're trying to get a little bit faster, right? They're just seeing the end result, and they're trying to catch your end result by doing a bunch of fucked up shit. So
I think that last portion, Tyler, is something that's important to me, right? So I'm trying to get people to see the difference between a drill, a qualification, and a challenge, right? Drills are something that we grind out, we do over and over again to get better at a skill set. The challenges and the qualifications are something that just quantify that drill and the work we've put in. So if I were looking at this, and until we've discussed it, I looked at it, well, this isn't really a drill, it's a qual, or it's a challenge, right? Where's the learning aspect? What are we trying to achieve? What are we trying to get better at? Because I see 4 different positions that should be really drilled independently of each other, right? But now that talking to you and kind of seeing how you've run this and the iterations that you've gone through, you've taken the time to use this drill to get better at each position. And that's not until later that you turn it into basically a qual or a challenge, right? And I just think it's important, and it's semantics, right? But I think it's important to make that distinction when we're training, that there's a difference between drills and qualifications or challenges. Because most of the time, the average Joe is going out and seeing a drill, seeing a challenge or a qual, and just drilling that to get better. And it doesn't work that way. Just because you run the same shit over and over, you don't get better. You have to break those down. I think it's important to reiterate that you broke this down earlier before you just tried to run it fast. And I think that's an important distinction to make.
No, and it's something like you'll never get, like, that drill is, you know, 10 years of very specific training or something for me in so many different ways. And again, from the gas gun side or the carbine side or just the athletics or whatever. But it's, like the internet's great at ruining things, and they'll see it and they'll turn it into whatever they want. And the guys, mm-hmm. I think that are, you know, the people who don't know, like, okay, that's why they're there. Hopefully they go out, they learn something and they figure something out. And if they're going to be, you know, jerks about it or whatever, then that's just, in a lot of ways, it's part of the process. I think we've all maybe been there to where, you know, we're trying to learn things and see how things work and maybe misunderstanding or, you know, the Dunning-Kruger effect or, you know, all this other stuff. But it's, I think, like something I mentioned earlier, but something I talk about probably ad nauseum in class is heuristics, like learning through your own experiences. I can sit up here and tell you this is what's going to happen and whatever and this and that, and even that's sort of biased, but having guys go out there and have that light bulb click for themselves, like, hey guys, you need to get, you know, in these points of contact and your optics going to move less. And the guy does it and he's just like, oh my God, if I just move my gun, my rifle, you know, an inch to the right, I wouldn't have the wobble that I had. Like in the ladder drill, it's like I'm running my bag and my rifle all the way up against both, you know, horizontal and verticals. And it's something so easy. And, but having guys see that for themselves, you know, that inductive style of training is coming to their own conclusions and having them afford them the opportunity to have a chance to be creative with their own learning, I think is hyper important. And it's something I absolutely do. And something, you know, you mentioned, Jeff is like, I just saw a red dot handgun class up in Connecticut, you know, a bunch of SWAT guys and agency guys up there. And the beautiful thing about me not being a law enforcement guy or whatever is I can kind of run my mouth in some ways and not worry about getting fired. And I told them before the class, I was like, guys, I think your qual is bullshit. I think it's too easy. I don't think it's a great sign of anything other than it takes the burden off the agency and puts it on the individual officer basically to, if something bad happens, the agency is like, oh, well, we did what we could. He passed the qual. It's not our problem. And I think it's bullshit. And it's like, you know, you said there's a difference between training or running the drill and training, right? Like, you know, breaking down the individual positions and doing all the stuff like that stuff that I'm, you know, I know you guys work on the same thing on my end. But the issue is the internet's only ever going to see blips of it. Right. So that's the importance of training. And I'm not here to make people go sign up for classes or anything. But it's like you can only get so far, you know, by yourself in so many ways. The internet's a great place too, because you can learn almost anything just by watching YouTube videos and podcasts and having great mm-hmm. discussions and stuff. If people want to take the time to do that, but most people are lazy and they don't want to invest in those things. And bringing this all back around, you know, talking about filming, you know, you guys mentioned like watching, you know, breaking down the individual things. Tyler, you're saying like, hey, well, my footwork, or I need to do this better or whatever. All professional athletes watch game film, right? Like they all study. It's something we did in college. We watch every play of every practice and every play of every game we ever did. And watching those kind of things, I think is hyper important, because you find those little bits of inefficiencies and things you don't even realize you're doing, you know, oh, I stepped wrong, or I did this, or my knee wasn't in the position I thought it was. So kind of doing those things and watching film, I think is hyper important. And if you can be honest with yourself, I think people can make those corrections largely on their own too, to kind of find the, you know, the progress that they're looking for, as long as they have the discipline to do it and they're willing to be honest about their mistakes and what they see. Right. So
I got a couple things on that. The first one before I forget it is, talk about the film, and we brought this up, Jeff, what, like two episodes ago?
Yeah, it was like two episodes ago. Absolutely. Like,
talking about like you can record yourself and that's cool, you know. Now, Chris, I fucking love football. All right. I love college football. And every damn Sunday morning at 1 a.m., I am awake watching Ohio State play somebody. Okay. And here's the thing, like, I love it. I played a little bit of it, but I don't know the ins and outs of it. If I were to watch a game film, I'd be like, oh, look, they're in a trips or they're in an I formation. But, you know, there's little details that I just don't fucking know. Right. But there is a podcast that I listen to, and he has a coach's film breakdown. Right. And he goes through and he talks about all these details that the average guy doesn't know. Like, look at this guard right here. He's gonna pull. He's supposed to come over here and hit this guy. He misses that block, blah blah blah, right? And I almost think it would be beneficial if like you or me or anybody out there, really, if you're following them and you're using them to get better, if we had a segment where, you know, say for instance, I take your video, Chris, and I slow it down, I say, all right, we look at his first position here. What are we looking for? Right. And then we were able to break this down, because what me and Jeff talked about a few podcast episodes ago was you can be that person who records yourself, but if you don't know what the fuck you're looking for, then you may be correcting things that are fine. Like, how do you know? Right. You just don't know what you don't know. The other thing I was thinking about was, do you have an AR-10 or a large cartridge gas gun? Have you tried to run this grill with that?
I have not. And part of the reason is I'm testing something on that large frame gas gun. And that's actually not an excuse at all, but it's I probably need to really do this. So hopefully I can make it to the range this next couple of days or this weekend, and I will see if I can't make sure that I bring that thing to try to give it a go.
Dude, I think that would be so sick. I mean, you see the disparity in the competitive side, right? Like the years that I, like, you know, I did a couple PRS gas gun matches when they still had them. You know, I did fairly well. Some of the quantitative performance matches, the Bill Guestman match, like I won those like 3 years, and I'm always using 5.56 because the distances aren't that great. You know, you're shooting out to maybe 800 at max. So if you're using a good projectile, you're going to be fine. Wind is going to get you, but if you can call wind again, you'll be fine. But the recoil is so much less, so your ability to re-engage faster and just move with a smaller platform. So I'd be interested to see, one, how you perform with your large frame gasser, but then two, if you practice with that, because we talk about it, like I shoot a 6mm in competition. There's like zero recoil. The thing is a fucking laser beam. Yeah. But if I want to practice good positioning, recoil management, I'm going to go back to that 308. I'm going to go back to something that's going to, you know, slap me in the face if I'm not doing what I'm supposed to doing. So I'd be curious of how maybe doing a few runs with your 7.62 would improve your 5.56. Like, I don't know. I just geek out about shit like that, dude.
You mentioned a couple of things, and I'm writing these notes down or whatever, but you know, the first couple quantified performance matches I shot, I was shooting 5.56 guns. And again, I'll be 100% honest. Like, I lack in probably absolute understanding of my data, because I don't really have anywhere to shoot long distances except for down in Blakely, Georgia. So I have to travel to go do it. So I'm not as intimately as familiar as I would like to be with the ins and the outs of the platform or the round. I think I'd do better because I still reload a lot. But I still am missing that. And because of that, my win calls are absolutely the, if I go back and look at all my scores, and I gripe to Ash about this a little bit about the scoring and stuff, is like, I had 3 or 4 stage wins, you know, in most of those matches, like overall stage wins out of everybody shooting. And it's because, you know, I'm faster to do certain things. And like, yeah, some of those were the short little 20-second stages or whatever, you know, the closer in stuff, you know, 200-300 yards. But that's where I shined in so many ways. And then the limited round count stages where, hey, you only have 8 rounds to get these hits, I throw 6 rounds, you know, because I had a bad wind call and, you know, the target's hung up on a, you know, on a berm, so we're not getting splash or anything. It's like, that's where I absolutely lack. And I'll drop 3 positions because of one stage and those penalties, you know, those 30-second penalties on that stage don't account for my 26-second stage win on the, you know, the earlier in the match. Yeah. So, and that's why I kind of moved to a larger caliber, because it's a cop out or whatever, but it's a little more forgiving in some of those conditions, right? To where I don't think the winning those couple stages with a 5.56 gun ever made up for even 1 or 2 misses that I might have got away with a larger caliber that handled the conditions a little bit better, if that makes sense. And then you saying like, hey, training with that harder caliber, that heavier caliber, that heavier gun, I think makes a lot of sense going back to, man, I bet if I, I can almost guarantee if I had to go shoot that 5.56 gun and do that again, it's like, oh man, this is way easier to manage. And I'm actually really glad you said that too. So that's, I get to kill two birds with one stone, as I get to try the drill a couple times with the 308 or the 6.5 or whatever. And then it's like, okay, bring the 5.56 gun back out and see, you know, how that translates back over. Cause I know for a fact, and we mentioned earlier too, is like, everything's on a sliding scale for me. Is like, I know if I have to hit a no card, or you mentioned if I have to hit a no card, I know I don't have to get as good of a position or as stable a position because of the target size. Or, you know, conversely, you said as well, is like, if I know that I only have to shoot one round, I know I don't need recoil management. I know I can give up something to get out of there faster because I know I don't need recoil management. And that's something, the first couple of times I ran the drill, I was hyper lazy on my position. I wasn't getting behind the gun enough. So that 1 mil deviance or whatever that you were talking about earlier is like, I know for a fact I was messing that up. So when I went back and made those corrections, I was like, oh man, I'm not putting my shoulder in this gun because I'm so worried about getting in and out of this position quickly. I knew that I was actually lacking. You know, so I thought that was worth touching on with, you know, the comments about, hey, what am I even looking for? Or, you know, stuff like that, or the positional work specifically, is like, those are things that I had light bulb moments in myself when I was like, oh man, this, I'm not doing what I need to on the front end to give me the results I'm looking for on the back end. So
I think the scoring, I'm trying to remember the last time I did that quantitative performance. You can win a stage, but I think earlier when I talked about, like, you win a stage, you get 100 points, and then everybody else gets a percentage. I don't think it's like that anymore. I think it is a cumulative time over the entire match. So you could have, you know, Jeff, this is where I see you at. I see you in this realm. You could have 6 perfect stages where you win 6 stages and you're the fastest. And then you have 2 stages where you just absolutely shit the bed and you have like 8 penalties.
That's me.
And you just lost the match. Like, that's it right there. It's gone. You know, so about that scoring system, I mean, what I think it does is it's a twofold thing. One, you might be the best shooter out there, but that scoring system is not going to cater towards the best shooter. It's going to cater towards the most consistent ones. The ones that can perform, maybe not the best, but pretty damn close to the best every single stage, right? And I like it, so.
Well, I'm not the pistol shooter I used to be in so many ways, but like, you know, one of the rules I had when I was shooting competitive pistol stuff, like at least starting off, was like, hey, if I just don't shoot any penalties or don't do this, like I know that I'm capable of winning the stage or shooting fairly well, right? And like, that's the thing, is a couple second or third or fourth place finishes over a long day are way better than, you know, the first and the 42nd.
Yeah.
But like, I think USPSA still uses the percentage scoring system, and it's on a rolling scale too, which I think is awesome. And that's the difference, is like, hey, if I win this stage, I get 100% of these points, even if it was only 20%, or if it's the total time match, I know that I, like, hey, I need to be more deliberate, because like I said, these 3 or 4 penalties, and I have 3 or 4 matches to prove it of scores. Cause you know, I'm in the car for 4 hours. I might as well look this over. It's like, hey, I won 2 or 3 of these stages, but they were 20-second stages or, you know, 30-second stages. They'll never make up for one miss on any other stage. So that's when I realized, I was like, okay, I'm not doing this correctly. And again, the rules are the rules, right? If my skill set is as good as I think it is, I should be able to apply my skill set to any rule set within reason. And I think, you know, that's just something I was like, okay, I need to address this. So I did moving forward, and I think I did slightly better either in how I was training or, you know, gear selection or whatever. But it's just something I didn't pick up on until a match or two in, and realized that I was like, oh, hey, these stage wins don't matter in the grand scheme of things. You could throw that stage out entirely and it still wouldn't affect the misses I had somewhere else.
Yeah. Oh, exactly. Exactly. Jeff, you got anything to add on that before we talk about the,
I mean, I don't, again, I'll bring it back to a golf analogy, which is that's why there's match play and stroke play, right? Like, you know, you could be 4 under through 9 and all it takes is a couple of blowout holes to fucking be one or two over par. So that's why
any of that means.
Well, that's why there's different formats for different matches, right? So it's the same thing. It's match play versus stroke play.
It's as unfamiliar. I was in the gym yesterday morning, and they've got the number two and the number three seed of tennis playing each other. And I see dude serve it, goes across the net. The other guy hits it. It hits the fucking net. In my eyes, that's supposed to be a point, but I'm not seeing the numbers change on the fucking screen. So I just don't understand some of your shit.
That's a let.
I don't know what it is. It's a fail.
I played tennis growing up.
It's a fail, and he should have got fucking a point for that shit. Fucking golf, tennis. Ugh. All right, so moving on. So I heard you say it, so now I can properly say it, right? But what is Darcy? At first, I was like, the fuck is a dark? Like, I've not heard of it, but I'm also not totally engulfed in that realm. But what is dark? And why the hype over Soldier Systems and all of these other firearms news outlets about dark selecting the L9 manufacturing rifle?
So it's Darcy, right? So that's how it's pronounced, Darcy, and it's a direct action resource center, right? And in the last couple of years, I've been super fortunate to kind of go out there. I originally got an invite like a couple days out before a class for an industry slot, because I'm an industry person or whatever. But Rich, he'll hate that I'm talking about him in so many ways. But Rich is, him and his wife, Caitlin, are the owners. And they've been around for 27 years teaching that facility. And Rich was like a shawl shooting instructor, I believe, in Mid-South or whatever back in the day. And, he's a former Green Beret. But that place has been, absolutely instrumental, I think, on the domestic side of the house, as well as, the mill side for training. They used to do contracts, month-long contracts out there on the mill side. And then now it's basically on the LEO side, predominantly at this point, teaching like hostage rescue, counterterrorism style stuff. So, Darcy is a place, but it's about the people, right? So like I mentioned, Rich probably hates that I'm talking about it, but Rich has become a really good friend of mine. And it's always about the people, right? It's not about a person. It's not about a thing. It's about the people there, right? So the resource center, direct action resource center, I think is massive, because for 27 years, they've had hundreds or thousands of students kind of come through in that time period from all over. You mentioned D-Platoon earlier. I believe a lot of their explosive breachers have gone through Darcy's breaching program, right? So like, you got guys out in LA, you got guys in New York, you got guys in Florida, Arkansas, all these other places, Texas, like all these guys have all these, experiences, and having them combined into one place and into one kind of, gathering of people and stuff is like, man, that's a lengthy time frame of experiences that people have had, but also different levels of experiences, right? So the small town guy who's never had an operational breach can go to hang out with Texas DPS who's had they had 10 last week or whatever it is. So it's like it's a place for people to go and a community for people to have to kind of like really professional end training, right? So you mentioned some of the force on force stuff earlier, and it's like, man, LECTC one, they'll shoot probably 85 or 87,000 rounds of Sims in that week as a class, right? So Rich always says it's a fighting school. It's not a go do CQB school. It's actually a leadership school, in my opinion. Those are my words, but it's like I think it's a leadership school disguised as a CQB class. Guys go in and they think they're going to learn CQB, and they learn leadership, task org, all these other life lessons, if you will, over the course of those 6 days. Just for that specific course, but it's almost ruining training for me. And I rewrote a lot of my training after having been there a bunch, because I felt like, man, the fundamental skill development stuff is hyper important. And it's something that I still do every week. I go to the range and I work a individual skill set or whatever it is. But I think giving giving people the experience to go out there and fight for a week, or the depth that that place provides, is something that a lot of places or classes don't really offer, especially on the civilian or LEO side of the house. I think there's a lot of middle schools, from what I can tell, and have been fortunate enough to experience in some aspects. I think those are a lot more deep and ingrained, or in depth, I should say. And I think that's something that we largely lack on the commercial side. Like, hey, let's go take a class for 2 days and we'll all hang out and drink beers and stuff. It's like, no, we're going to go out there and we're going to fight for, you know, 6 days or whatever it is. And you guys are going to learn some stuff, you know, one way or another. And I think that is worth its weight in gold. So it's hard to explain in so many ways. I think anybody who has been there would agree in a lot of ways that it is a very special place. A lot of people who haven't been there will say it's a cult, and that people, you know, think it's weird and dumb and whatever. But I've met some of the best people I've ever met in my life out there, that are true, honest, good Americans. And I think, like, it's worth, if anybody gets a chance to go, I think it's worth the ticket to go. So, but you know, you'll find very little on the internet in so many ways. Cause like I said, it's not about personalities or whatever. It's about the experiences and the training, the people that are involved, you know, sharing, doing good things for good people. So, hopefully Rich approves of that, that statement. So
Jeff, you heard of these guys? Muted. Can't hear you.
As is typical, I have jackhammers going on. Okay. That's kind of the norm around here. No, I haven't. I looked, I couldn't find a bunch online, at all.
By design.
At all. So I have not, and maybe someday I'll get an invite.
All right. So I did do a little research, right? And I pulled this quote from Richard, who he's quoted. So let me ask this question. What is a custom gas gun? How would you expect a custom gas gun to perform? Because he's got a quote in here. How does a custom, the L9 manufacturing patrol rifle performs like a custom gas gun that you purchase off the shelf? And I thought that was interesting. Is it legit or is it fluff? I've seen custom guns that fucking suck. Like, they just don't run. They got their gas hole too far from their muzzle, or they've got their gas hole too close to the muzzle. Your dwell time is fucking off. Like, you know, and I'm sure you've seen it, fucking Chris. There's fucking companies making gas guns that are just making gas guns because people will buy them. They don't know what the fuck they're doing, right? And they don't understand the relationship between the gas, the pressure, the bullet traveling down the barrel. Like, this shit is lost to them. So how would you describe a custom gas gun so that I can understand how this L9 holds up to that candle?
And again, I'll say this, I'm not speaking for anybody. I'm not speaking for Rich. I'm not speaking for L9 or anything. But you know, my sentiments and my understanding of, I think what they mean by that, I think would, it probably jive. Right. So like, you can go into any store in the country basically and find an off the shelf rack rifle, right? Like a gun that you can pull off a rack that was built on an assembly line. Right. The guns, like, I know probably most of the armors by name. Like, I know, I can tell you exactly who built my rifles. And like, those are good dudes that really take what they do seriously. I can't say that there's not some assembly line procedures, but like, those guys are in there hammering, building guns at their workbench and stuff like that. And something you mentioned, you know, like custom or whatever, like a word that I might use would be tailored, right? Cause like, coming from the three gun side of the house, right? Like, I'm used to run low mass bolt carrier groups and JP captured springs and all this other stuff, right? Like, to kind of give me the best the best performance in a narrow window. I would never be overseas in a sandstorm shooting this thing, so I don't have to worry about certain things, right? So again, everything's on a sliding scale. I give up something to gain something. I might give up a little bit of reliability for performance, right? But that's kind of the thing, talking about a purpose and intent that you mentioned first thing is like, man, this gun is going to be designed for this agency or whatever. It's going to be suppressed 99% of the time. You know, so it's like, we learned this last week. I got to shoot probably about 4,500 rounds or 4,000 rounds out of 10,000 rounds last week on this rifle. And it's like, I learned a lot on my end, right? Both as a shooter and stuff like that, but also as somebody who might be building these things or what to look for. And, you know, like, hey, if I'm going to build a suppressed gun 99% of the time, like I'm going to adjust that gas port size slightly, right? Like I'm going to run a different length barrel, a different gas system. You know, how much dwell time do I have? The A5 buffer system that Suns and L9 is particularly known for is like that A5 system is more consistent over the lifespan of that gun while it's running, you know, from dirty to clean. It gives you a larger window of acceptable use, you know, while that rifle's running and performing and stuff. So like I'm doing my own kind of torture test on one of my personal guns that I teach with. And it's like, man, that thing's got tens of thousands of rounds through it. And yeah, it's been cleaned and lubed and stuff, but it's like putting 10,000 rounds through a gun in 4 days taught me some different things that I didn't realize and learn. Right. So I think tailored is a good word. So, you know, what's the goal of the gun? What's its job? What's its uses? How can we tailor that platform to best suit the end user? Because man, like, you know, we're shooting for accuracy, you know, we're shooting on a sniper roll or a DMR roll or a gas gun roll. Like, hey, I need a way more accurate barrel, you know, in that gun, or I need a proper tuned gas system and stuff. Whereas like, hey, this is going to be, you know, 300 rifles to a bunch of patrol guys, like they'll probably never clean this thing, or, you know, half those guys won't even shoot it or take it out of their rack. It's like, hey, we can give up a little bit on the gas port size, right? It might be a hair gassier than we need it to be, but we know where it's going and what it's doing, right? We know their ammo's trash, but guess what we can't pick as vendors is certain agencies can only run certain ammos. Like, well, this ammo shoots better. It's like, well, yeah, it's not what we buy. And you're fighting these battles, you know, on the back end, and it's like, okay, well, you have to spec the best thing you can on your end, you know, to kind of suit their needs. You know, if they're, hey, we can't afford that. It's like, okay, well, here's an option that you can't afford that we still think is the best option, right? So tailored to end user, I think is the best way to describe that. You know, because I think almost every, there's some base platforms, like their M89 and stuff, like their M76, those are base platforms. But even then, more times than not, I think when they come through is on the agency side, at least, there's somebody who's like, hey, we got to run surefire cans, or hey, we got to run this. And it's like, okay, we know we have the data points to say, well, I'd reduce your gas port size slightly to do that. And that's something that, you know, more times than not, they can account for on the back end. So.
Oh, I've definitely been down that road, you know, working with Falcor Defense so close, traveling around the country and doing a lot of their law enforcement stuff for their sniper systems on the gas gun side, and having different platforms and having to say, okay, the gun's got to be precise, but at the same time, it's got to be reliable and it's got to function. So you start to play with the lines of like, and you know, you could see mil-spec all day long, right? You got loose tolerances, right? You've got tolerances that allow the gun to shoot in conditions that aren't ideal, but it's also not the greatest in terms of precision. It might be accurate, but it isn't precise, right? So as you tighten those tolerances to squeeze more precision, then your reliability starts to maybe deter, like fall as conditions around you get worse, right? So you're always trying to find that overlapping area where it's like, okay, what's the loosest we can go in terms of some of these tolerances that's going to keep us reliable in the shittiest conditions, but we're still going to maintain 1.3 MOA, you know, like the fucking Knights armament crap gun that we got stuck with here in the Marines. So, I mean, it's a catch you know, you find yourself trying to play in the middle. So I understand where you're coming from. As far as the rifle itself, besides the people, besides the armor, because the articles that I was reading, they were talking about the people that build these rifles. And I can understand that. I can relate to that. What would you say, like, as far as information, when you said the M89?
Yeah.
M76?
Yeah.
I don't know shit about those because their website is so, like, I think their website's two pages.
The website's trash.
They're all getting revamped probably in the next several days because it's been a huge project for everyone involved. So
I like click on it and I'm like, ooh, rifles. And it's like the next page is nothing. And I'm like, where's all the fucking rifles at? So that's what made it click for me. I was like, this has got to be law enforcement or military. Like, to people that you're not really marketing to. You know, you're not selling them on the website. If they're on your website, they already know why they're there, you know?
The question got brought up and it's, they're like, well, when are these available? And it's like, they've been in service for years. There's a ton of agencies that I can't name that are agencies you'd probably recognize that have the guns. Right. So they're already in service and in use. And again, it's just all the websites, all the information, all that stuff's getting, you know, redone. You know, we all recognize that things need work. So we're all in the process of doing that kind of stuff. But they're out there. So,
you know, myself, when I saw that these are, you know, custom like in sort of that verbiage kind of thing, in a previous life, when I was an armor at the police department, and that's my career prior to this, prior to owning my security company. You know, I was in charge of purchased, you know, hundreds of rifles, you know, hundreds of cans. I did all the teeny for our departments. And the first thing that I would look at when I saw, yeah, these are like a custom rifles, I'd immediately go, I want nothing to do with it. I want something that's going to run and something that's quantifiable because another agency runs it and it keeps my liability low. Right. You're saying that these have been in service for a while and you already have multiple agencies running these. Which is, I think, speaks to itself. But I get the point that Tyler's making, which is, you know, anytime I see the word custom, my hackles kind of go up when it's something that's going to be put in service, right? I've stayed away from a lot of rifles that ran fantastic, but they were sort of onesie twosie hand built, and I start to go, well, that's not what I need for, you know, 150 patrol guys to go beat up, right? You guys have a base rifle, and these rifles are tuned for the end user is what you're saying.
Yeah. And that's, I mean, so like they build a rifle their way to their specs, but like, you know, the agency that we were just out with, last week, they spec'd a rifle and it was our job to, deliver a rifle to their specs to the best of what we had to offer. And you know, we use the A5 buffer system instead of the carbine buffer system they requested and they allowed it. You know, there's a couple small little differences there. Like, you know, they requested certain triggers and certain suppressors. So it's like having the ability to flex those things and still make the gun run, you know, using maybe just a change of a spring or something, I think is super important. Because again, going back to the gas port size and all that, the buffer system and all these other things, like those things matter. And if we just put out a full rack gun and said, hey, well, this is what we already make, you'll like it. Like, I think that's a catch-all in a dangerous way. You know, it's like, hey, this thing's way overgassed and it does work, but it's way overgassed. Or, you know, hey, we don't have the little bit of customization that we actually need. Right. And again, going back to the ammo thing, it's like, what's the ammo we have? And it's like your ammo, will change, you know, how we have to run that rifle. And how does that rifle run when it's dirty? So, like it's, and I, you bringing up the custom thing is actually, I mean, I wrote that down. I think that is a good point because we're always looking for things that are, deterrence or, you know, like, hey, they see something and it's immediate red flag or something. And I think that's a good point. That's worth discussing. Just the perception of things. And again, that's like almost every agency, at least that I've dealt with training wise or otherwise, has been like, hey, a lot of them will buy an off the rack gun and say, hey, just give us this. This is what we can afford. So like, hey, there's an option for that. Or like, hey, we want this to do this. we're running the new Huxwork can or, you know, the flow through. It's like that thing doesn't push as much gas. So like, hey, we have to run a different setup, you know, because of this. So I think having the ability to shift and pivot and tune is a good thing, as long as it still falls within that window of like Tyler was saying, kind of, you know, reliability and performance. Like where do we get away with the tolerance stacking is something that we always talk about. Where do we get away with that? Does it still do its job? You know, does it still check all these boxes? But it does it slightly better than the other option, which is maybe, you know, on the fringe of one of those boxes or, you know, in that window, if that makes sense.
Yeah. Dude, the gas gun world is, you know, like I said, a lot of people don't understand it. Having the opportunity to kind of work with Falcor and learn so much more, you know, it's kind of like working for US Optics at one point in my life, where I just learned so much shit about scopes that it just opened up a whole different world to me. So it comes back to this one, I want to say like probably 2016, Jeff. I just took a bunch of parts out to the range with me. This is when we were back at the old training facility, and I put this AR together, and I go out and fucking shoot, right? And it barely, the bolt barely extracts. And I'm like, oh, fuck. You know, what did I build here? And having that knowledge of gas guns, I'm like, okay, well, what are some things that I can change on this rifle to try and get it to work? Because, I mean, the barrel that I have, that's what I got. The gas tube, can't change the length of it, you know, like, certain parts are fixed, but what can I adjust? I'm like, well, fuck, I have this adjustable gas block. Let me play with that. So we play with the gas block a little bit. And then I start, you know, breaking down the back end of it. And you brought this up, like, you know, it's more than just the gas tube, the gas, you know, the length of your gas system. But now you also have your bolt carrier and how that bolt carrier relates to your spring and your buffer weight, right? So ultimately, it's going to sound janky as fuck, but this is one of the best cycling rifles that I've ever had. Is what I ended up looking at was like, oh, fuck, I've got basically a full-length buffer system in a carbine tube. That's not going to work, right? There's too much pressure on the bolt. The bolt wasn't being allowed to cycle. So I'm out there with, like, snippers, dude, cutting the fucking, putting spring back in, taking a shot, cutting, putting spring back in, taking a shot, until I found that perfect length where, like, everything just worked the way it was supposed to. And there was no math or science behind it. It was more like a trial and error, right? But that is how interdependent everything on those fucking gas guns are with each other. You know, people think, oh, I'm just going to go to Rainy Arms and buy this ultralight, you know, tin coated fucking bolt carrier. It's like you buy that bolt carrier and you're changing so much more than what you realize. So, you know, if it's a good rifle, if the L9 is solid, which you say it is, and, you know, a lot of departments are using it, then clearly there's a lot of that thought process that goes into it. So that's good.
No, it's a system. You know, that's one way I always say things, is like, I set my rifle up to be a system. Like, if I'm doing one thing with it, like, it, you know, does it do everything else that I need to do? And then does all the other gear that I have around me support that? You know, and it's like, I think that's a super important thing. And, you know, like I said, man, I have Noveskis, I have ADMs, I have Lantax, I have a couple other, you know, builds, things that I threw together, BCMs, three or four of those. It's like, I have 20 rifles probably in the safe that I've shot for the last, you know, 12 or 14 years or whatever. And it's like, I've shot all those enough, I think. Maybe I didn't know what I knew now, but it's like, man, just having a no BS kind of, you know, gun that runs reliably over a longer span of things, I think is just super important for me, you know, right now, especially, throw it out there a little bit as a lifetime warranty. You shoot out your barrel, they'll replace it. You break something, they'll replace it. So it's like buying a, you know, going to buy a car, and like, hey, these tires are bald. Like, okay, you have free tires, right? So,
I did see that on the website. That was cool.
Yep.
So are you guys tuning them the same way, where you'll shoot them each individual rifle and then cut the springs until they fit?
No. And I'm not doing that either. You know, obviously all this, and Tyler said it earlier too, is like, you know, there's, there's a mathematical formula here where these things should check out and be right and work. But at the same time, like how it feels and handles and stuff like that, there's always something to be said for that kind of side of things too, the artistic side. So I appreciate both those aspects, absolutely. But you know, they will QC everything. I think every gun gets shot 9 times before it leaves, and then also every bolt carrier group gets shot 9 times. So everything's been tested and double tested. And if there's something that doesn't meet spec, they will pull it. If it's a individual part issue, they'll swap the part, or if it's just a stacking issue, they'll pull the whole thing, and stuff like that. So there's no snipping of springs on the workbench.
Still the best rifle I've ever had, I'm just saying. So all right. Last two things. First is, so your logo, right? We talked about when you kind of started Vail Solutions. We're kind of in the 2000s.
I think I know where this is going.
So I am not impervious to people copying what we do, right? How many fucking mile stickers are out there, Jeff, where all they did was cut our fucking name off the sticker, Chris, and put their name in. Yeah, there's another one. There's a company out of Utah, right? And it's cool. You know, initially I think I was like, what the fuck? And
I know.
I'm like, okay, it's fine. I am flattered, you know. So anyways, your logo. Where does that style come from? Because we have you, who is the OG, from what I could tell, right? I'm sure there's other companies out there, but we have Mountain Ops, Max Effective, and Modern Day Sniper all using that same style.
Yeah.
But you're the OG. So is that...
So, and I'll probably answer this in a roundabout way too, but it's like, so I have an art degree. I went to college and I played football and I have an art degree. So I've done art design probably as long as I've been shooting guns or all that stuff. So I'm very artistic and I still do a ton of graphic design as part of my job, both for myself, my own company, and several other companies. But I think, you know, there's a couple quotes like good artists copy, great artists steal. And I'm not saying that that has happened anywhere either on my end or somebody else's end. And I'm also not saying I'm the OG either, because somewhere that I borrowed or leaned on that idea from something else I saw somewhere. But I do know for an app, I probably have the sketch actually somewhere. I remember drawing that on a piece of paper and inking it and putting in Photoshop and all that stuff and correcting the math and the fucked upness of it from doing it by hand. But as far as like my creative process of things is like, I can look at almost any logo or anything, even if it doesn't apply in any capacity, and I can pull something I like from it, either the geometry. I'm sure you guys have seen the golden ratio of, you know, it pops up in nature all the time, but it's a, it's a something that designers lean on all the time. And it's like, it's a rule that they kind of abide by. So just having symmetry in this kind of design style and stuff like that, like it's somebody probably saw something somewhere. And again, it may not have even been me. And they see something they like about that, even if it's not apples to apples, they see the geometry, they see the shape, or they like the hard lines and the edges and stuff. And they can apply it to, you know, like, oh, hey, my S looks like an M. If you cut the bottom out of the S, it looks like an M. So it's like, oh, maybe that fits in their design, right? Maybe that's a letter they use. So just on the creative side of the house, it's just like it's how people look at things and kind of can interpret it or use it in their capacity. I see a letter A that I like. If I flip the A over, it's a V. It's up, you know, I just cut things out. So it's just kind of having that kind of mindset or creativity to kind of use things is probably why I think a lot of those, you know, they probably saw something that motivated them, and they, you know, they might have stolen it. I don't know, but you know, they might have seen something they like, and they were able to apply it to kind of what they thought might look good. So I can at least say I did all my own graphic design for my own company. So I don't know if they hired somebody, but I always did all mine. So
see, my initial thought was more of a military-ish style, right? If you like look at Mountain Ops, you know, anything with the word ops in it kind of drives you towards like that military feel, right? Operations.
Yeah.
You know, Max Effective, they're in the gun industry. I don't know what his background is, but it's kind of the same thing when a lot of people associate firearms with militaristic shit. Same thing with modern day sniper. The logo itself looks like some style of ranking insignia. So I wasn't sure if that's where it was.
No, we get that all the time too.
Cool. Well, I just want to bring that up that you're, in my eyes anyways, the motherfucking OG for that.
That was a very PC answer of a way to say that something like think exists. So yeah, I would have just said they stole my shit, but good for you.
Well, I did say it earlier that somebody straight up stole my ghost design, and unfortunately for me and them, I guess they you know, they're a much bigger company, and I can't afford to go to court and play that game with them. Otherwise, I'd sue the fuck out of them. But if I see them somewhere, I'd like to, you know, say something about it.
You just got to throw blows, man. You got to pull out.
There's your un-PC answer.
Yeah.
All right. Last thing. Pistol, carbine. You get one drill to share with everybody. That is your, I'm fond of this drill. I think you'll get a lot of benefit out of it. I'm stamping my name on this bitch. Go forth, do good things. What's that one drill, best bang for the buck, that you would send out to anybody listening to this right now for pistol or carbine, your choice? I know, we'll put you on the spot right now.
Does it have to be, you know, like Bill Drill or the you know, Triple Nickel, or does it have to have this readily available name or something? Or
it doesn't even have to have a name, dude. You could just describe it to us.
Okay, well, then I'll give you, going back to our other conversations, like the concepts and the principles of a drill, right? Like, I think if you learn, instead of like, hey, this position works here, the concepts and the principles of the drill. So learn what you need to do, you know, mobility, you know, efficiency, all those kind of things. Basically, one thing I run at my carbine classes, and I'll give you the brief version for guys to hopefully go out and experiment with. If you go to the range, find as much fucked up shit as you can on the range. Find a cinder block, a chair, a wheelbarrow, a wheel. Find anything you can, right? This kind of translates over to some of the gas gun positional work stuff. But it's like, go find all that stuff, lay it out in front of you, and then just work. Find the shittiest position you can find to shoot off of. And then find a way to exploit it to your advantage. So, you know, and something I mentioned or wanted to mention earlier is like, don't look at this like I'm shooting off a ladder, or don't look at this like I'm shooting off a fire hydrant. Like, I would never do that. And I was like, I think if we were in a complete empty parking lot and somebody put that in front of you, I think we would all agree that we'd probably try to use that over standing freehand, trying to make a shot at distance for accuracy. Right. So, find as much random shit as you can, lay down on the line, work your movement of getting in and out of position repeatedly, a little bit under stress, do this stuff, and just shoot all those weird fucked up positions and find ways to exploit them to your advantage. You know, target size, the smaller, the better, all that kind of stuff. But I think if you guys, if people can do that, I encourage people to get off the flat range as much as possible, you know, and use the environment as much as possible. So I think doing some form of that kind of drill with a rifle, and shooting from as many different positions off as many different objects, as fast and as stressed and as far as possible, I think that's worth its weight in gold. So I think a lot of people can gain a lot from that process, as long as they have some reflection and honesty in what they're trying to achieve. So if I could do one thing, I think that's probably what I'd do.
Okay. I mean, we do something similar. Right. Yeah. We have props all out there, and you know, we kind of have a principled approach to it. We have 9 principles that go into positional shooting, and every position you're fighting for how many of those principles can be achieved in this position, right? And we call them principles because it's something that you can do regardless of the prop that's in front of you. if you only practice on how to be great shooting off of a 55-gallon drum, you're not learning how to apply these principles. You're just learning how to shoot off of a drum, right? So it's understanding what goes into that position, and then how do I apply it here? How do I apply it there? How do I apply it here, right? And then adding the stress to it, or we like to have the students compete against each other. You know, we'll have a KYL rack up there, you know, where the smallest target's like 3/4 of an inch and it sits at 225 yards. And it's like, you know, shit like that. But yeah, I agree. It's a great drill. We do it all the time. Yeah. I'm here for it. So, well, cool. Hey, Chris, man, I appreciate you taking the time out. You know, even though I fucked up all the time for you, Jeff, I didn't tell you. I was telling him we'll be ready around noon because I was thinking your time, but I didn't ask him what state he's in. So it was really like 3 p.m. for him. Well, it didn't dawn on me till this morning.
To be fair, my wife said, what time's your podcast? And I said, well, it's at noon. Tyler said noon, so we should probably start about 1:30 or so.
Whoa.
And then it's like 3 a.m. at noon your time. I get it. Or my time. But then I get the link and it's like 12:15. I'm like, fuck. All right. I gotta go tell everybody to go shut up right now.
Yeah, dude, I was on time today. What can I say? Oh, cool. Hey guys, appreciate it. You guys taking time out of your day to be on the show. Jeff, we're going to get down with this again tomorrow. Try to get, I'm still working on a timeline. I don't know if it's going to happen tomorrow, but it's possible to get Dave Castro on here and kind of talk about some muscular CrossFit stuff and some of the things that he's been getting into. Pretty heavy on the 22LR shit. And not that I'm a big fan of 22LR, but I'm kind of interested to see how it plays into being better at your rifle overall. So
fair enough.
We'll see. We'll see. Hey guys, appreciate it. We are out of here. Thanks, guys.
Hey guys.